gallons are, I'm not exactly aware. However, we'll take a pull at them just the same.
People have the odd idea that the director's a kind of lion tamer, and they're all saying with actresses, no, 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 I will not do that. And then you say, you will do that, and all that absurd thing.
I was reading a book the other day.
Reading a book?
Yes, it's all about civilization or something. A nutty kind of a book. Do you know that the guy says that machinery is going to take the place of every profession?
Oh, my dear. That's something you need never worry about.
It's a great eternal mystery, which is denied us. I don't know why a painter can make a certain line and I can't make a certain line, and why an actor can call on something in himself that I cannot do.
Yes?
This is the bridal suite. Would you send up a couple of caviar sandwiches and a bottle of beer?
What? Who is this?
This is the voice of doom calling. Your days are numbered to the seventh son of the seventh son.
And also, the director has the enormous advantage of hearing it. You see it and you hear it. So you have that detachment.
May it please the court, I strenuously object to the methods being used in this matter, Your Honor, for no other reason than it's an insult to the dignity of the court. Now, we all love the circus. I love it just as much as anybody else, I'm sure. But it seems to me... No.
You've got to watch actors, and they say, well, you told me that yesterday, now you're telling me this, and then you have to have the skill and say, well, I was wrong yesterday, and I'm right now.
Forget me. I'm a bad loss. You come too late.
I don't believe that. It's not too late, not for you, not for me.
Don't say that, Esther. I might begin to believe it.
But by and large, you give the tone of the whole thing. You give the vitality. And if a director sits down, everybody else will sit down. And that is among his other duties, to keep it going.
But you know me, fellas, when things get tough, when I feel a worry coming on, you know what I do. There, and then the worries are over.
George Cukor and Talking Pictures arrived in Hollywood almost simultaneously. A stage director, he was hired to supervise dialogue.
I liked Hollywood the moment I got here. I felt lucky here. And then I had thick skin and a lot of determination and stayed on.
Within 2 years, he was directing. He admired the moguls he worked for.
I think they really knew, for the most part, what the public wanted. If you had an idea at all, they would encourage you to give it to them. And they were men who could make decisions. They were in a position to say, yes, I'll make this picture, and yes, I will spend money. And they were anxious to get whatever you could offer. Also, the services that you got at the studio, they had enormous resources. They'd buy the best books. They would engage the best cameramen. Also, they realized that the coin of the realm was talent. And they respected it.
Talent, its innocent rise and its sometimes pathetic fall, was the subject of his first important movie. What Price Hollywood starred Constance Bennett.
Oh, boy. Darling, how I love you, my darling. I love you, I do.
She was a waitress dreaming of movie stardom. Cukor loved actors. Telling their stories became one of the great themes of his career. What Price Hollywood is an early version of the more famous A Star is Born. The difference is that the new star's drunk and disorderly discoverer is a director, not another actor.
Quiet, everybody! Quiet!
Max Carey was played by Lowell Sherman, who was also a director himself.
Okay, you remember, you're a pretty girl, and this poor sap is going to propose to you. So give it some zip, some animation now. Come on.
Yes, sir.
Now try it once again. Now, come on. No, no, not on your heels. And don't clench your hands that way. This is a love scene, not a fight.
Yes, sir.
Now, come on. Right now, come on, be gay about it.
Hello, Buzzy. You haven't proposed to me yet tonight.
What is it, Rosemary? Are you ill?
Wrap it up. We'll take it the first thing in the morning. I think you better get me another girl.
But Mary works all night on her role, begs for a second chance, and impresses the studio boss.
Hello, Buzzy. You haven't proposed to me yet tonight.
He was played by Gregory Ratoff.
Terrific! Lights! Who is that gorgeous creature?
That's the little girl you just threw out of here.
Send her up immediately. Make a note of this, Miss Spiegel.
Yes, sir.
Maybe she's a great discovery.
She has something.
Here I am, sir.
Hello. Let me look at you. Fine. Gentlemen, sit down. Well, what's your name?
Mary Evans.
Mary Evans? No good. We'll change it.
Mary's a grand old name, Saxey.
All right, we'll keep it. Well, Mary, I'll tell you what I do. I'll give you a contract. A long-term contract for 7 years. Miss Spiegel, get my mom on the phone. I want to tell her I have discovered a new star.
Who discovered a new star?
All right, Maximilian Carey discovered a new star.
You're welcome.
I'm in pictures.
As Mary's star rises, Max's declines. He will end up a suicide, just like Norman Maine in A Star Is Born. Cukor's star also ascended. He teamed with producer David O. Selznick. Their specialty was literary and theatrical adaptations.
Baked potato, yeah. A baked potato, sir.
Oh, thanks.
They're all hot, sir.
Even so.
We're not going to wait forever for you to play us a debt.
If you don't pay, we take all the rest of the
You've got to know why you're doing this and this piece. You've got to know why do I want to do the Dickens? What is the essence of that? And I try to capture that.
David Copperfield was one of Cukor's classics, not least because of the inspired casting of W.C. Fields as the sly, boastful, yet curiously honorable Mr. Micawber.
I have thwarted the malevolent machinations of our perilous enemies. In short, I have arrived. My bones, my little beauty, my children, my own.
This is Master David Copperfield, who has come to lunch with us.
Oh, just so. Pardon me, children. All that we have is yours, Master Copperfield. Our domestic comfort, quiet, the privacy. Call them your own.
Thank you, sir.
Count on us, now and forever.
Fields played the sort of a scallywag who was having a tough time with life, and also that he wasn't too honest and he was trying to get away with things.
Freddie Bartholomew was Copperfield.
What is it? Come, little friend, open your heart.
It's only that I shall miss you so very much. At Murdstone and Grinby, I feel so alone and desperate. I do indeed. You've been so good to me, you and Mrs. Micawber. And as long as I had such friends, I couldn't despair.
My little friend, you're like one of our own.
But now that you're going, and there'll be nobody, well, out in the world I shall do. Indeed, I do not.
My motto has always been, nil desperandum. In short, never despair.
He was born to play this part. He was Mr. Micawber. And I don't think he'd played as he'd always played himself or things that he'd created. And I found him very sympathetic, very nice, and very inventive, but never outside the character of Micawber.
Copperfield, at present, I've nothing to bestow but advice. Still, that advice is so far worth taking, I have never taken it myself, and am the miserable creature you behold. Young friend, I counsel you. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £19. Result, happiness. Annual income, £20. Annual expenditure, £21. Result, misery. Farewell, Copperfield. I shall be happy to improve your prospects in case anything turns up, which I may say I am hourly expecting.
I think that we all have limitations, but I don't like it when people put artificial limitations on you. Why shouldn't I be able to do a serious, dramatic thing? You have to dig out what is real and valid. Let's say Camille. There were things in that that were conventions, that a bad woman would ruin a young man's life. But if you do it so that everybody understands it and you dig out the reality and the truth of it, because the truth will move people.
Camille is the story of a doomed love affair between a naive, handsome aristocrat and a notorious courtesan. It is perhaps Greta Garbo's greatest role.
She was supposed to be dying. Eventually, she does die of TB. But she created this. She just did a very delicate, she cleared her throat. And by some way, you knew that this woman was going to die. She was unsentimental about herself. She was tough, she said to the young man who idealized her. She said, look here, I'm just a girl like all the rest. I'm a tart here like all the rest. Now, don't fall in love with me. And she was trying to protect the young man from himself.
No one has ever loved you as I love you.
That may be true, but what can I do about it? You should go away and not see me anymore. But don't go in anger. Well, why don't you laugh at yourself a little as I laugh at myself and come and talk to me once in a while in a friendly way?
That's too much and not enough.
But Robert Taylor, who was very young at the time and very picturesque, you understood his plight very sympathetically because it was his folly was the folly and the impetuousness of a young man.
There. You can lift yourself in when you come back.
You're an angel. I won't go again. Marguerite Gautier.
I saw that picture for the first time. I'd seen bits of it on television. And when they had the retrospect of my pictures, as they do for all old gentlemen, I was staggered at the when you saw it on a large screen, at the lightness of touch. And I know what she created, the wantonness, the perversity.
Someday I should get temperamental and object when doorbells ring while I'm trying to play.
Did the doorbell ring?
Does my music shut out the rest of the world for you?
You play beautifully.
You lie beautifully.
Thank you. That's more than I deserve.
Oh, it's not half as much as you deserve, my dear.
That usually is a sort of a sobbing part, a victim part, but she played it. She was the author of her own misery, and it had enormous eroticism and boldness.
Perhaps it's better if I live in your heart, where the world can't see me. If I'm dead, there'll be no stain on our love.
Don't think such things, Marguerite. Even if we can't go to the country today, think of how happy we were once, and how happy we shall be again. Think of the day you found the four-leaf clover and of all the good luck it's going to bring us. Think of the vows we heard Michel and Gustave make, and that we're going to make to each other. This is for life, Marguerite.
I don't think you spend your money to be tormented in the theater. Well, now, I think if you're going to see great eternal tragedies, the Greek tragedies, or Dostoevsky, or the things that, well, you might submit to that. But to be tormented by people trying to make a buck, and whose intellectual opinions and whose skill is not to be particularly respected, I just think it's, I prefer the pomposity of it puts me off. And also the unattractiveness. I think it's a kind of life. You're not doing Gorky's, the lower depth. You're doing a fake version of it, you know, and a fake sentimental, soft version of it.
Oliver? Darling, I'm simply out of my mind. I'm still shy one couple, and I just can't find an extra man. What am I going to do, dear?
Well, you can do something for me, dear. You can invite Dan Packard and his wife.
You're joking. Ask that common little woman to my house?
Dinner at 8 was typical Cukor. All-star cast, comically inconsequential surface, surprisingly dark undercurrents.
Hello, Mrs. Jordan. Of course I remember you. I've seen you at the races.
Mr. Jordan and I are giving a small dinner for Lord and Lady Ferncliff, two very dear friends of mine from England.
Gee, that sounds swell to me. Well, it's awful nice of you to ask us, Mrs. Jordan. We'll be glad to accept. Well, goodbye.
Don't you want to know the date?
Oh, sure, honey. Friday. A week from tonight. Dinner at 8. Thanks. Well, goodbye for real this time, Mrs. Jordan.
Where have you been all this time?
Came as quick as I could.
Hey, wait a minute. Where's my change?
I had to go to a new place. Cost half a dollar more.
Who told you to go to a new...
John Barrymore's story was the darkest of the film's several stories. He's a ham actor down on his luck. His lover is the party giver's daughter.
Well, a little drink.
Any reason why I shouldn't?
No, of course not.
The very first shot, he's on the telephone, and he's what they called at that time, I shouldn't say it. He was a sort of Lambs Club actor, pretending to be very grand, talking to a society woman. And he said, let me put this phrase in. It was slightly actory at the time. He said, yes, yes, dear lady. He was being very grand and hambola.
Hello, Mr. Renault? This is Millicent Jordan. I don't suppose you'd remember me.
Of course, dear lady. Well, it sounds like a very amusing evening. I shall certainly try to come. At 8? Thanks very much.
He played, as I say, an ignorant actor, and he found out that an English actor had got the job that he desperately needed, and he'd say, I can be as English. I can be as English as anybody.
Who's gonna play the part?
This Cecil Bellamy.
That piffling little... Why, he's English in the first place.
Oh, the part says English explorer.
I can be English. English as anybody.
And he says, I can do Ibsen. And he just heard vaguely of Ibsen. And then he would strike this absolutely inappropriate pose. And he said, Mother dear, give me the moon, whereas the Ibsen line was, Mother, give me the sun.
I rather like the idea of going with Stengel. They tell me he does those highbrow plays. Ibsen. I want the moon, Mother.
Yeah. Now look,
he understands
Larry.
I'm to be starred, of course.
He played a second-rate, cheapish actor, which God knows he wasn't, and he did it with enormous wit and very subtly.
Well, Stengel, you're going to produce this play, eh? And you want me to act in it. Well, I...
Larry, this is just getting acquainted. You know, he's just crazy to play the part.
Just a minute. Let's get this thing straight. I understand from Mr. Kane here, but you wanted to know if I'd be willing to portray the beachcomber in this thing.
Wait a minute. Not so fast there.
Now, Larry...
In the first place, if I consent to play this part, and I don't say I will, it'll have to be built up.
Built up? The fellow's got one scene, and to find him dead on the beach. This isn't a play about spiritualism.
Don't forget, I'm Larry Renault.
Larry, for heaven's sake.
Shut up. Now listen, Stengel, I'm a name, and I know it. And so do you. And I'm not going on and play second fiddle to any cheap English hand.
Now, Larry.
8,000 a week, that's what I got. And I was going to get 10 till the talkies came in. So don't think you're doing me a favor by asking me to play in your ratty little show, because I'm doing you one.
For heaven's sake, Mr. Stengel.
It's all right, Mac. I'll see you tomorrow.
I wouldn't be on your rotten show, not Larry Renault. You know why? Because I'm an important artist. And you're nothing but a cheap pushcart producer. Pushcart!
He would listen sympathetically and try anything that a director might suggest. I remember the very touching end. And I suggested there was happened to be a stool, and I said, I think it'd be awfully interesting if he did this very ugly, middle-aged, awkward sprawl. And he did that so wonderfully, and then he pulled himself together and died showing his profile.
Larry Renault has turned on the gas, but he makes certain the lighting will be theatrically effective when his body is found. But the dinner party heedlessly proceeds, its glittering guests unaware of the irony in which they're involved.
Oh, Millicent, darling. Are we going to Florida this winter, sweetheart?
Well, I wouldn't count on it if I were you.
I'll miss it so. It's so wonderful to have nothing to do, just to lie all day in the sun. Yes, but you've got to be awful careful that you don't get blistered. You know, my skin's terribly delicate, and I don't dare expose it.
John Barrymore played quite a different role for Cukor in Bill of Divorcement. He was a newly recovered but still gently befuddled amnesiac. It was Katharine Hepburn's first movie, beginning her career-long collaboration with Cukor.
Katharine Hepburn is human in every way, and she was gifted at that time and had the originality. She'd been only acting for some time. She had clumsinesses, and she certainly had never acted in front of a camera. It was a wonderful part, and she made an enormous impression.
They would become best friends and eventually make 10 films together. She's the Barrymore character's daughter, but here he mistakes her for his wife, whom he's not seen for years.
What are you looking for?
Somebody's movement. Meg. Meg, my own darling.
I'm not Meg.
Oh, of course. I beg your pardon. I thought you were another girl. You see, I've been away for a long time.
There was an interesting moment in the picture where they'd first seen her, and she spoke rather forcefully, and the audience wasn't quite sure whether they liked her or not. And then there was, mercifully, an interval where she said goodbye to her mother, who was troubled, and you saw this girl go to the door, and she smiled, and you saw that she had this lovely smile, and the audience had time to take stock of her.
Goodbye, darling. Goodbye, Mother.
Bye, Sydney.
Goodbye.
Then she walked across this big room, and lay on the hearthstone, and then they could see that she moved beautifully, that she had a lovely figure. And it was at that moment that Katharine Hepburn became a star.
Cukor and Hepburn took their oddest chance with Sylvia Scarlett. She played much of the picture dressed up as a boy.
Oh, I say, that's marvelous.
That was a terrible failure when it was done. It was Katharine Hepburn. And now it's one of those rediscovered treasures. And every time they show my pictures, they said, oh, we want to show Sylvia Scarlett. And I'm rather surprised that they knew Katharine Hepburn and I are very amused by it.
But it's generally regarded as the movie in which Cary Grant became Cary Grant, surfacing his lower class English background and touching his screen character with a certain darkness.
He was a successful young leading man who was nice looking but had no particular identity.
Monkley, Jimmy Monkley, that's me. Little friend of all the world, nobody's enemy but me own.
Yeah, I can tell that by the look of you.
He knew what this character was, and he gave a marvelous performance.
There you are. He's got humor. He's got imagination, he has.
Now, I wish I could imagine why you coughed up that money.
You want to know why?
Yeah.
Because you're one of the right sort. Twigged it as soon as I kept my eyes on you. Keen, got plenty of ginger, ain't afraid to do nothing gain. That's you, am I right?
Yes, I...
Yeah, you could learn things.
Learn what?
Yeah. Who am I? Jimmy Monkley, gentleman adventurer. One of the orcs.
Orcs? Oh, hawks.
Yeah, orcs. Orcs, the word orcs. Sparrows and orcs. That's humanity. The orcs bossed over the sparrows. That's nature. Nah, you want to be a sparrow? Look at them all around you. What are they? Mere slaves. Me? I'm out to beat the system. I'm free. I see life. Easy come, easy go. That's my motto. I'm the fella for taking the chance. Rolling stone.
Yeah, I'm a rolling stone too.
You see, he didn't depend on his looks. He wasn't a narcissist. He acted as though he were just an ordinary young man. And that made it, he wasn't conscious of that. And that made it all the more appealing.
Cukor was now set to direct his first epic, Gone with the Wind. It was more than a movie to his old friend Selznick. It was a grand passion. But something went wrong on the set. Selznick would let nothing, not even friendship, deter his dream. He deferred to Clark Gable's wishes and fired Cukor. Much of what Cukor shot remains in the film, finished by Gable's pal, Victor Fleming. But Cukor, though hurt, refused to be devastated. Within a year, he was working on what remains perhaps his most widely beloved work, The Philadelphia Story. Hepburn had starred in Philip Berry's play on Broadway, controlled the screen rights, and always wanted Cukor to direct.
There is a trick of adapting a play to the screen. If you photographed a stage play, you'd see that it was very static. You have to adapt it and give it a movement, and sometimes a very subtle movement, and yet keep the cohesion of a play.
Tracy Lord is determined to marry the wrong man.
Oh, never mind, Eddie. I'll get up myself. Steady, Bessie. Whoa, Bessie. Whoa. Whoa, Bessie. Whoa. Here. There, whoa, Bessie, whoa. What's the matter, Bessie? You act worried.
Maybe it's because his name is Jack.
Hi-ho, Silva.
She's a headstrong woman who knows less than she thinks she does about her own heart. She's about to marry a self-made man who's not as well-made as he might be.
Look what your friend considers a wedding present.
Why, it's a model of the true love.
What?
A boat he designed and built, practically. He sailed her down the coast of Maine and back the summer we were married. My, she was young.
Yar. What's that mean?
It means, what does it mean? Easy to handle, quick to the helm, fast, bright. Everything a boat should be, until she develops dry rot.
If I were asked to read a script from the beginning out loud, I'd do it very badly, but I go great guns if the actor's standing there, and I have to make the hot suggestions, you see.
Where over the rainbow, way up high.
She has two would-be rescuers. One is James Stewart's slightly cynical, slightly radical magazine reporter. The other is her ex, C.K. Dexter Haven, reformed drunk and playboy, now full of romantic wisdom.
Don't stop, Mikey. Keep crooning.
Someday over the rainbow, way up high.
What is Miss Connor? Now, easy, old man. She's not hurt?
No.
Not wounded, sir, but dead.
Seems the minute she hit the water, the wine hit her.
Now, look here, Connor.
A likely story, Connor.
What'd you say?
I said a likely story.
Now, listen, if you
You'll
think
You'll be
that...
down directly?
Yes, if you want.
I want.
Hello, Dexter. Hello, George. Hello, Mike.
Second door to the right, top of the stairs. Mind you don't wake Dinah.
5 feet of made of clay, made of clay. Did you know? Good night, little man.
How are the mighty fallen?
The romantic suspense is sustained right to the end when Tracy finally makes the right, possibly inevitable, choice.
Hello. Good morning. Stop that music. I'm terribly sorry to have kept you waiting, but there's been a slight hitch in the proceedings. I've made a terrible fool of myself, which isn't unusual. And my fiancé that was, that is, he thinks we'd better call it a day. And I quite agree with him.
Peace is wonderful.
Dexter, what next?
2 years ago, I did you out of a wedding in this house by eloping to Maryland.
2 years ago? You were invited to a wedding.
Just
in this
alone.
House.
Here, put the swing in your vest pocket.
Don't have a bad
and hold in your hand. Which was very bad manners. But I hope to make it up to you by going through with it now as originally planned.
By going beautifully through with it now. As originally and most beautifully planned.
After World War II, Cukor's comedies were grounded in a more common reality. In them, the battle of the sexes sometimes became more deadly. He adored working with a remarkable new star, Judy Holliday.
Judy Holliday was an extremely intelligent, intellectual person, very well educated, very highbrow, very musical, and she was unique. Some actresses are very talented, and some actresses are talented and are artists. Well, Judy Holliday was an artist as well. She showed you truth through comedy. That is what an actor can do. And then, of course, she was a master of comedy and of subtlety and of understatement.
The qualities Cukor admired were on brilliant display in this scene. Innocence and vengefulness and suspenseful comic conflict. Hepburn is her defense attorney. Spencer Tracy is the prosecutor.
What?
Well, I got the case.
What case?
A girl named Doris Attinger shot her husband. I'm going to defend her.
She is a great believer in women's rights. Her mother was. Her mother was a birth control friend of Margaret Sanger, and she was brought up in this absolutely liberal tradition, and is a feminist, and sometimes I tease her about it. Oh, I said, look here, but if you just scratch her a little bit, she'd go into all the business. Women are not given the opportunities.
Why don't you let him go
what
by?
He wants the whole road. Now, look, all I'm trying to say is that there are lots of things that a man can do, and in society's eyes, it's all hunky-dory. A woman does the same thing, the same, mind you, and she's an outcast.
Finished?
No. Now, I'm not blaming you personally, Adam, because this is so.
Oh, well, that's awfully large of you.
No, it's not your fault. All I'm saying is, why let this deplorable system seep into our courts of law where women are supposed to be equal?
Mostly, I think females get advantages.
We don't want advantages. And we don't want prejudices.
Don't get excited, honey, and don't. Oh, you're giving me the Bryn Mawr rights?
Well, what did she try to do? She tried to keep her home intact.
Yeah, by knocking off her husband.
She didn't knock him off. She's alive. She didn't kill him.
She tried. She missed.
Well, all right. Now, suppose.
What do you want to do? Give her another shot at him?
No, I don't.
Spencer would, I'm sure, be preoccupied with the part. I'm sure he would be mulling it over. But he didn't articulate it because he felt that, if I talk about it an awful lot, then when I do it, it won't have the freshness. That is what is the immediacy that good picture acting has. But I'm not talking about improvisation. He spoke every if, and, and but in the text.
He's about to turn his wife's feminist arguments back on her in this great scene by Garson Kanin and Ruth Gordon.
Just pretend like they do on the stage, like Lawton Fontaine. You be Lawton, I'll be Fontaine. The other way.
Hey.
All right. Break it up.
Adam. Listen to me, Adam.
Don't you handle me, lady. I'm not nutty. Not any more than the average. You said it yourself today, didn't you? You said anyone is capable of attack if provoked. You bet, including me. Yes. Don't you move, young man. You stand as still as you can be.
Now, Adam. Adam.
You said that before.
Now, Adam, you're sick. Please. What do you think you're doing?
Teaching a lesson. Him first. Then comes yours. Now, get away, Amanda.
Adam, stop.
Get away, Amanda.
Don't you do it, Amanda.
Stop it, Adam. Stop it. You've no right. You can't do what you're doing. You've no right.
What?
No one has a right to...
That's all, sister. That's all I wanted to hear. Music to my tin ear. Liquid. If there's anything I'm a sucker for, it's liquid.
I think you want to give the illusion that it is improvised. That's what an accomplished actor does. But you hew to the line, to the text. It's very, very important.
Pat and Mike is a fable about what we would now call female empowerment. Hepburn is a great all-around athlete. Tracy's a roughneck would-be manager.
Get in touch with me. You know, there's a nice dollar laying around waiting for you and I to pick it up.
Well, I'm afraid I'm not.
I mean, legitimate, you know. Legitimate. Oh, there's a, you know, lady athlete, properly handled, always a market.
Always.
I don't think you've ever been properly handled.
That's right. Not even by myself.
Very few brains. Yeah, there's one thing I gotta say, though.
What?
Nicely packed, that kid.
Is it that?
Not much meat on it, but what's there is cheers.
In this tennis match, her opponent is a real pro, gorgeous Gussie Moran. Hepburn will reveal her fatal flaw. When her patronizing fiancé is present, all her skills desert her. Cukor didn't often resort to unusual cinematic effects, but he turns this scene, also from a Kanin-Gordon script, into a brilliantly realized bad dream. The Actress is one of Cukor's most charming, least known films. It starred Gene Simmons in Ruth Gordon's memoir about becoming an actress. One of its funniest sequences is about another sort of performance, Ruth's father's appearance as a gymnast. His wife was played by Teresa Wright.
Loved and respected Gene Simmons, who gave a wonderful performance. And there was a scene when she wanted to be an actress, and she stood on the steps in their house.
Oh, don't stand there like a dying cat. If you got something to say, come on, spit it out.
I want to go on the stage.
Well, what makes you think you got the stuff it takes?
I don't know.
And she was spouting things off rather badly. And Spencer looked at her, and he did something very funny. For no reason at all, he looked at the mother as though she had talked this girl into doing something.
Hurry up the camera, got to have the camera. Can't do anything without it. When I think, when I talk, when I drink, when I walk, if you want to catch it all in toto, you must be on the spot and of me take a shot, for everything I do is worth a photo.
But then he looked at her with this eloquent face of his, and his face even changed color. There was a black and white thing. And I said, that was lovely. He said, well, I remember when I told my father that I wanted to be an actor, and he looked at me. This skinny kid with big ears, and he said, oh, that poor little son of a bitch, he's going to go through an awful lot.
A Star is Born is a classic showbiz fable, with the Moss Hart script recounting an enduring romantic legend, a star on the rise, a star in decline, with a tragic love story played out against a background of glamour and falsity. Esther Blodgett has prevented Norman Maine from making a drunken fool of himself in public. They fall in love. He will sacrifice his career, which he's never valued, to hers.
Saved Norman Maine from making even more of a fool of himself than usual. I thank you.
You can do a picture about movies, like A Star is Born. Well, that's a very special experience. A little girl, you know, it's a Cinderella story, but the problems of her are special to movie actresses. But if you get beyond that to the truth of it, then you move the audience. And Judy Garland did with this extraordinary performance.
It's all yours, Esther. And I don't mean just the Cadillacs and the swimming pools. It's all yours, more ways than one. I hope.
Yes, Norman, go ahead. Say what you...
You're going to be a great star, Esther. Don't let that change you too much. Don't let it take over your life. You're very dear.
With her name changed to Vicki Lester, she succeeds as he fails. Like its antecedent, What Price Hollywood, the film mixes true movie anecdotes and instructive celebrity fictions. She's won an Oscar. James Mason's great performance turns her moment into a great movie moment, a riot of conflicting, cringe-inducing emotions.
Congratulations, my dear. I made it just in time, didn't I? May I borrow the end of your speech to make a speech of my own?
My method for gaining your attention may seem a little unconventional, but hard times call for harsh measures. I had my speech all prepared, but it's gone right out of my head. Let me see. Well, it's silly to be so formal, isn't it? I know most of you sitting out there by your first names, don't I? I made a lot of money for you, gentlemen, in my time through the years, haven't I? Well, I need a job now. Yeah, that's it. That's the speech. That's it. I need a job. That's what I wanted to say. I need a job. It's as simple as that. I need a job, that's all. My talents, I may say, are not confined to dramatic parts. I can play comedy, too. Yes. Well, play something, somebody.
Norman, darling.
The movie was a mixed blessing for Cukor. Without his consent, the producers added scenes and cut scenes before it was released. These stills in this outtake are from a later attempt to restore it. As with Gone with the Wind, Cukor made no public comment.
If you've got some good stuff, that is the vitality, that's the heart's blood of the whole thing.
Cukor could sympathize with Norman Maine, but he was utterly without his self-destructive impulse. The actor would make a romantic sacrifice. Cukor would make 13 more movies and win an Oscar in the years left to him before his death in 1983.
If you look life square in the face and say, well, I lack here and I lack there, and you take a sharp account of yourself and you try not to be envious or resentful and sorry for yourself, I think you stand a chance to enjoy life. That's a message, isn't it? It's a beautiful message.
Here she is, ladies and gentlemen. A star that shines bright and high. As you know, this program is being broadcast all over the world. Before you sing for us, I know that your millions of fans everywhere are hoping you'll say a few words to them. Won't you?
Yes. Hello, everybody. This is Mrs. Norman Maine.
George Cukor was always on the side of people like himself, the gallant, the gifted, the self-aware, people who might be knocked down but never out. Their truth was his truth. In his stylish life and equally eloquent movies, he never wavered from it.
Gleich auf TNT Film. Ein Episodenfilm von den Meisterregisseuren Martin Scorsese, Francis Ford Coppola und Woody Allen. New Yorker Geschichten. TNT Film. Großes Kino.
Die Zeit ist reif für ein